Hello, statisticians. This is Dr. Jeffrey Saver. I am the father of Mr. Young Saver, who you know so well. And he has asked me to give a guest lecture today on the two-sample t-test, illustrating it with an example from my own medical research. I'm very excited to be here and be with all of you. Let's skew it.
Nice. Perfect. Yeah, the skew could have used a little more action, but I liked it. That was great.
This is lesson 8.4 in the course sequence, Hypothesis Test for Two Means. And we'll be talking about a study from research I did with colleagues in the US and Europe on a new treatment for stroke, taking you through statistics based on data from my own research. Stroke is injury to the brain from blockage or rupture of a blood vessel. And in the blockage type of stroke we studied, a clot lands in a brain artery, cuts off blood flow, and a region of the brain begins to die. If we can reopen that blocked artery, then we can restore the blood flow and save brain. In 1995, the drug TPA became the first treatment for stroke. It chemically dissolves clots, but in the next 20 years, no major advances occurred. And TPA is not at all a perfect drug. Even when you get it, less than 40% of people who have large vessel occlusions like this clot here in the brain artery are able to live independently after the stroke. So in this study, we tested a new potential treatment for these patients, a stent retriever. Stent retrievers are these mesh columns that are on a wire that's advanced through the leg artery all the way up to the brain artery, expanded into the clot. They capture the clot, and then you pull the stent and the clot out of the body and out of the brain, restoring blood flow to the threatened region. In this study, we measured patient outcome using the modified Rankin scale of global disability. This has a 7 levels, a score of 0 is the best. The lower the score, the better you are. No symptoms. A score of 4, moderately severe disability, means someone needs assistance from another person to walk. And a score of 6 means the person died. So if the stent works, it will move patients down this scale. Now refer going forward to this as the disability score for patients. In our study, we took 191 patients with stroke and randomly assigned them to standard medical care with TPA or to extra care TPA plus our experimental stent treatment. So by computer, they were randomly assorted into these two treatment groups, and we ended up with 93 patients receiving standard care and 98 receiving the stent. And we measured which group had lower mean disability scores 3 months after the stroke, after they had finished their recovery. So today's key analysis focuses on this 3-month outcome. Did the stent treatment work based on that analysis? If you'd like to follow along and take notes, this is available at this website. The topics today will begin with the two-sample t-test for a difference of means. We'll now go through an informal version of this hypothesis to understand it conceptually, and later the formal 4-step process will be reviewed. So here are the results from the study. And remember, if the stents work, the treatment group should have a lower average disability score. We're interested in the population mean, but we have the sample means, and here's what we found. The disability score in the stent group was 2.26, in the control group 3.23. So there was lower mean disability by a dramatic amount. 1-point change on this scale is a very big difference in outcome for patients. But there was lots of variation between patients, and there were fewer than 100 patients in each group. So we have to ask, could the difference in outcome have happened by chance alone, or did the stents actually improve patient outcomes? We take our default belief until evidence convinces us otherwise. The default dull belief is assumed, and the unproven research hypothesis is our alternative hypothesis. Here, the default belief is that the current standard of care is best and the new treatment does not improve outcome. And the alternative hypothesis is that stents improve patient outcomes. Numerically, we are looking at the hypotheses are with regard to the population means in outcomes between these groups. And we can state the null hypothesis that stents don't improve outcomes as saying that the population means on the disability score are the same in both groups, and the alternative hypothesis that the population mean on the stent-treated patients for disability score will be lower than patients treated with control. So let's set these hypotheses up. We subtract the control from both sides, and with the no hypothesis, when these are equal, this will yield a value of zero. On the other hand, the alternative hypothesis, when we subtract the control means from both sides, the lower stent group disability score minus the higher control will give us a value less than zero. And it's more mathematically convenient to write the hypotheses in this way. Recall the logic of these hypothesis tests. We start with the null. Okay, I'm going to assume stents don't help, and ask yourself if the null is in fact true, how likely is the data that you've gathered to have occurred where the stent group had much lower disability scores than the control group on average? And you draw a conclusion under my assumption of no treatment benefit. We hope our observed data is unlikely, so I reject my earlier assumption and I'm convinced stents help. So here are the calculations. We assume the null is true, no difference. And then we ask, well, if it is in fact true, how likely is the data that we've gathered to occur? We enrolled 191 patients. And what estimates for the difference between these means are we likely to get if stents don't actually help? Versus, so for that, we need to find the randomization distribution of the sample means from all possible random assignments. And here that is, and you can see it is a bell curve centered on the null hypothesis value of zero. Typical differences we'd see between the stent groups and control groups that will occur by chance alone will tend to occur close to the null, whereas more extreme differences indicate a very unlikely result and a likely genuine treatment effect. And here is the data from our study. We'll now plug this into the equation. First, we put in the sample sizes from the two groups. Since we don't know the true population standard deviation, we'll use our sample standard deviations and a wider T distribution to account for the extra uncertainty. We plug that in and we calculate that the standard error is 0.258. Next, we have to calculate the degrees of freedom. There, we will take one less than the smaller sample size. We had 93 patients in the control group, so we plug in 92. Now, let's see how this plays out graphically. Here is our data, and the difference is in the means is 0.97. Where does that end up on our graph? You can see it is way out here to the left of the graph. This is the type of result that makes physician scientists' hearts flutter to see a result that is so far from the null distribution. But we have to statistically ask how unlikely was our data? How many standard errors away is it from the null? That's the question that the T statistic assess. Remember the 68, 95, 99.7 rule. 68% of all possible sample means are within one standard error of the true mean, and 95% of all possible sample means are within two standard errors of the true means. So how unlikely was our data? It's a distance of 0.97 away from the null. The distance of standard errors is 0.258, which means we are 3.76 standard errors away from the null, way out here. This is where 95% of all values lie, and we're way beyond that. So 3.7 is a very unlikely result. What is the probability of getting this specific result or a more extreme one? That is the p-value. And it is the area under the curve that is beyond the 0.97 value. With calculator stuff, we can conclude that the p-value is 0.0001. That means there is a 1 in 10,000 chance that these results arose by chance. They are highly unlikely to occur if there is a true null effect. They strongly suggest a genuine effect because they're so unlikely. So to recap, is there convincing statistical evidence that the stent lowered the average disability from stroke given the mean difference of 0.97? We assume the null is true. How we evaluate how unlikely our sample data is, and it turned out to be very, very unlikely. Since it is so unlikely, we can draw a conclusion. Under the assumption that stents provide no added benefit, the actual data is highly unlikely. So I reject the null hypothesis. I reject the dull assumption of no treatment effect. And I accept the alternative hypothesis. There is convincing evidence that the stent lowers disability from stroke, which meant that for the first time in 20 years, we had a new beneficial therapy for stroke patients.
All right, Dr. Saver, that's very weird to call you that, Dad, but thank you for presenting to all of us. I'm gonna take over now for the four-step process from our AP Stats FRQ lens of doing this. So remember the four steps for inference. This is a way to organize your work such that you get full credit on FRQs for inference problems. So here is a hypothesis test problem that you might see using the same data. And it will ask, do the results give you convincing statistical evidence? When you see that language, we know, okay, I have to do the four steps for inference for a hypothesis test and show all my work along the way. The first step is to state the hypothesis, significance level, and define your parameters. So here are the hypotheses we defined. The significance level alpha we set to 0.05 by standard, and then we have to define the parameters we do below. Then we plan. So we're gonna name the inference method we're gonna do. This is a two sample t-test, and we have to check conditions. Why are we checking conditions? Well, recall, we used a normal curve and we approximated with a t distribution, and that only works under certain conditions. So if these conditions are not met, this whole inference procedure is gonna be flawed. And recall what these conditions check. We do the random condition to make sure that we have an unbiased center, the 10% condition to make sure that we calculate properly the spread, and to make sure that we can approximate with a normal and then a t distribution, we need to check that third condition. So to check those, the random condition, patients were randomly assigned to either receive control or the new stent treatment. So we're good, we are gonna have an unbiased result. And note, if we're sampling rather than doing an experiment, we need to verify that the data come from two independent random samples since we have a two sample test. The 10% condition, well, actually in this case, we don't have to check the 10% condition because that's only for sampling. This is an experiment. So we don't have to worry too much about that. And then for our normal slash large samples condition, we need to make sure the sample sizes in both groups are greater than 30. They were both greater than 30, so we're good there. And then to actually perform these calculations, you could do it by hand, like my father showed, but there's an easier way you can do it on the AP exam. Just go to your calculator and perform these steps. If you want to try it out, take a pause and check out those steps. You want to show what you plugged into your calculator. So you show, I did a two sample t-test. Here were the parameters I plugged in. And you report the t-test statistic. We were 3.76 standard errors away from the null hypothesis. And then you report your final p-value. Then finally, use the information to draw a conclusion. Here's the conclusions template that we use for a nice, concise conclusion. In this case, because our p-value was 0.0001, which is way less than our alpha value of 0.05, we rejected the null hypothesis. In other words, we have convincing evidence that stents lowered disability from stroke.
And here is today's medically driven discussion question about ethics in medical trials. Researchers who perform the trials do not know the cumulative results, so they can be unbiased as the study goes on. But there are independent scientists who monitor the trial data and stop the trial early if either the treatment seems to be hurting patients or the treatment is so good that it'd be unethical to not give it to everyone. In the stroke stent study we reviewed today, the study was stopped early by the independent scientists because the results were so good. Originally, we planned to enroll 750 patients, but the study was stopped when we showed dramatic benefit after enrolling 191 patients. So your discussion question is, you are on the monitoring committee for a new drug that aims to lower cholesterol levels. Researchers aim to enroll 300 patients in the trial. You look at the results for the first 150 patients, and they're the results shown up here. Would you stop the trial early? Why or why not? And as you ponder that, I will thank Mr. Young Saber, or as I know him, Dash, for the privilege of letting me be with you today.